Muncher.
In a world filled with war, hate, suffering, and Justin Bieber, two guys fix it all with a battle about a movie. One film, two opinions, one coin, two sides. They feud. You decide. It's time for Film Feud.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Film Feud, the podcast where we debate whether top-rated movies should be top-rated. I'm Vidur.
And I'm Vikram.
Hi, Vikram.
Pranam, Vidur.
Ready to feud?
I am so ready for this one.
Oh, Pranam, by the way. I missed
it's
greeting
okay.
You back.
I'm used to it.
In our mother tongue.
You mean Indian?
Yeah, Indian. Fluent Indian, I speak. Oh, Vikram, why don't you tell the good folk what we're doing here?
My pleasure. We pick a movie from the IMDB top 250. We toss a coin. Heads argues for and tails argues against. Simple.
That's right. Simple enough. So the movie we're feuding this week is
Batman Begins.
I am Batman.
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 Batman Begins.
We both suck at the Batman voice, turns out.
It's computerized, man. We're supposed to suck at it.
Should we just put a hard stop to doing Batman voice?
I cannot promise anything.
Okay, fair enough. But just in case nobody could understand what we were saying, the movie we're feuding this week, Batman Begins by soon-to-be Sir Christopher Nolan.
No doubts about that. Yeah, this is going to be one exciting feud.
It's going to be a high-stakes coin toss because we're both Nolan fans. That being said, nobody would argue that Batman Begins compares to some future Batman movies that Nolan made.
I think we should just do the coin toss.
Fair enough. Let's go for it. Why don't we do the coin toss? I'm going to toss the coin. Heads means I argue for the movie and tails means I argue against. Let's go. And I got tails.
Just go home, dude.
What do you mean?
There's no point for you to stay right now. Just leave.
I already showed my cards earlier. Not as good as future Batman movies.
Right.
Much wrong with the movie.
Right.
It's a reboot. You know.
When was the last time you saw it?
I have not watched this movie at least, I don't know, in 5 years.
And when was the last time you saw the other movies of this trilogy?
Probably the same amount of time. I haven't seen them for a long time.
Same here, man. I'm actually very excited to see because Batman Begins is the one I remember the least. So rewatching it is going to be pretty interesting. And I have no doubts it's going to be great.
Oh, sure. I got tails and I'm against and you're for. So now it's going to be amazing to rewatch it. Why don't we just watch the movie and find out?
Let's do it. But before we jump into our episode, a quick shout out for Hubhopper.
Hubhopper is India's very own podcast app, with the largest directory that brings you thousands of unique shows and stories from every imaginable genre.
You can now listen to your favorite podcast, Film Feud, on Hubhopper. That's Hubhopper.
So go ahead and download the Hubhopper app from the Play or App Store today. And if you like it, review it and share it with your friends.
And with that, let's go watch the movie.
Let's do it. First things first, Michael Keaton is the best Batman of all time, and this movie just reinforces that.
Are you serious?
That's serious.
Are you serious?
That's serious.
Is Tim Burton the best Batman director of all time?
No, the best Batman director of all time is Zack Snyder.
Zack Snyder?
In the little section of Batman beating up goons in Batman vs. Superman, which, by the way, did it better.
Oh, so just that one section of direction there is the best Batman direction of all time.
It's true. I mean, Batman by itself can be very interesting, but, you know, the comic Batman, The Dark Knight, no reference to the 2008 movie made by Christopher Nolan, The Dark Knight really shines through in Zack Snyder's BVS.
I'm surprised you're bringing Zack Snyder into this, man, because you're coming dangerously close to looping in Ben Affleck into the conversation, and I'm sure
in George Clooney into the conversation, and it would still be a meaningful conversation.
Wow.
Relative to this piece of trash reboot origin story. This is the amazing Spider-Man starring Andrew Garfield of Batman movies.
Oh, this is just gold right here. By the way, side note, the George Clooney movie, you know how much it's rated on IMDb?
How much?
3.7. It's 3.7. Even IMDB is like, yeah, that movie's so bad.
I think it doesn't get enough credit. It was from a more joyous time. Right. Where is the joy in this movie?
Batman's supposed to have no joy.
No, that's what you would say about all comic book movies because these became a hit. And then Marvel came and inserted back joy. It's possible to have joy and darkness. For instance, Spider-Man manages to accomplish both. This is just joyless. It's as bleak as its cinematography.
Wait, you sensed darkness in Spider-Man? Which Spider-Man are you talking about, just to be clear?
Homecoming? That was pretty dark. No, I'm kidding. I think like there was obviously darkness in the sense it always used to start out with Uncle Ben dying and, you know, him doing messed up things in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Forget Spider-Man for a moment. Let's focus on Batman.
You brought it up.
Christopher Nolan is wasted here.
Christopher Nolan is an auteur.
No doubt he is. What was he doing in this movie? I haven't seen it in so long. This is like, it's not even challenging for him and it shows. It's only when he started doing Inception, maybe crazy villains like the Joker in The Dark Knight, and then Interstellar. Like, this movie's not ambitious at all. It was just, the credit that I give to this movie is that it took the superhero genre and made it realistic. But turns out that also makes it boring, which is why maybe they don't make comic books that realistic. That's all that Nolan managed to accomplish.
I actually disagree with you, man. I put a lot of weightage into making it realistic. So Nolan, when he created the Dark Knight trilogy after Batman Begins, he said that he's creating something called cinematic reality, which could be misconstrued for direct reality, but it's realism within cinema. So he's taking characters and plot lines which are based off comic books, which we know are not realistic at all. But he still managed to ground these iconic characters within the roots of reality. And I think that's... So just to brush that aside so lightly, I think is not fair. It's very tough to do that. No other Batman movie has been able to do this. No other superhero movie has been able to do this, where it takes characters like
Batman. Aha, I got you. The remaining Nolan Batman movies did it. Boom. Argument failed, lawyered.
I mean, that's actually a concession from your end if you don't realize it. So I'll take that, yeah.
Ooh, did I get lawyered? Actually, no. I don't agree. Okay, fine. Finish your point.
No, I'm just... I pretty much wrapped it up. That's what I tried to say, that to take iconic characters like a Batman or a Superman and yet make a storyline around them which feels real, and these characters feel real, like day-to-day people who are conflicted or burdened by guilt or something like that, it's very tough to pull that off. And he does that in spades in this movie.
These characters feel as real as any other movie. I mean, all Christian Bale needed was for Ra's al Ghul, a.k.a. Liam Neeson, a.k.a. at one point, he says, my wife was taken from me. And it just made me so happy because this was pre-taken.
That's what I was wondering.
Anyway, I mean, Liam Neeson, Ra's al Ghul might as well be saying to Bruce Wayne, with great power comes great responsibility. The only difference is he's doing fear, anger. Let me summarize the first act of this movie for you, okay? What actually happens in the movie is that Bruce Wayne's parents get killed. Boo-hoo, as usual. And by the way, it's totally his fault for dragging his parents out of the opera.
Yeah, that's what he thinks too.
Yeah, I know. And then what kind of opera happens with like this crazy, creepy alleyway at the back that they exit onto? It just makes no sense. But forget that. Then he goes on the run, I guess, on the lam after going to college for a bit. And he lives the life of criminals. And then he meets Ra's al Ghul, who just channels his fear or anger into something, right? After a point, especially when the Ra's al Ghul, Bruce Wayne, typical superhero movie training montage is happening, which is so stereotypical and so boring, how he magically becomes like basically super powerful ninja, just the way Doctor Strange magically becomes super powerful wizard, piece of time, in an unexplained period of time. It felt like Ra's al Ghul was just saying fear over and over. And then Bruce Wayne was responding anger. And then guilt would be thrown in. It would be like, oh, fear, 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 ninja, anger, fear, fear, anger. Oh, you're an idea, legend, anger, fear, 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 fear.
That sounds like
revenge. Oh, and then Michael Caine comes in. Never. That's the first act. He's like, oh, you still haven't given up on me? Never. That's it.
That's the worst Michael Caine impression, firstly, I've ever heard. And second, that sounded like an EDM track, man. You could be a composer right now. Fear, 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 EDM, fear, 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 never, bass drop.
Nolan's already done it. I would be plagiarizing Nolan if I created that song.
Okay, if you're done with your horseshit summary of the first act,
why don't you do a better Michael Caine impression if you think you're so much better than me?
I can try.
You haven't given up on me, have you, Alfred?
Never.
No, that's shit as well.
My favorite Michael Caine line from the movie is when his dad has Bruce in his arms after he's just fallen into the well, cave. I don't even know what that is.
Well.
And they're just walking really nicely into the house. And Michael Caine just looks at him. He's like, took quite a fall, didn't we, Master Bruce? I love Michael Caine.
That's
dude.
It. That's your favorite line.
I love Michael Caine.
Mine's man. When he tells Bruce when he comes back from the dead that
you can borrow the you Bentley can borrow for, like, my Rolls.
You can borrow the Rolls if you'd like.
Yeah,
that's the best one for sure. Oh, and then also when he gives him shit for not being able to lift the burning log off him. What's the point of all those push-ups if you can't lift the log?
Just to have presence of mind to crack a joke in that situation.
Oh, genius. Genius. Part of Nolan's genius. Why don't you give credit to Nolan for that?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah,
Otto.
I do. Yeah.
I have a question for you. Do you like The Dark Knight Rises?
No.
I don't either. I think it's like the weakest of the three films here. The only impressive thing about that
movie is... I agree with you, apart from the fact that Batman Begins is the weakest of the three films. Yeah.
You don't have to be so blatantly obvious.
It doesn't have... Okay, so Bane actually represented this sort of tour de force, right? This villain is weak. A villain makes a comic book movie, usually. The villain is weak. Who is the villain? It's like this weird twist with Ra's al Ghul, where of course the famous actor is playing the villain's subordinate, then he will obviously turn out to be the villain. And the other villain is the Scarecrow, which is like... terrible. I mean, the Scarecrow as a villain is bad. Cillian Murphy's portrayal is stupid. The only villain I like in the movie is actually Tom Wilkinson. I just love that guy. The guy who plays Falcone.
I agree. Yeah. I literally love him as an actor. I'm so glad he was part of this movie.
I like him as an actor too. He did a great job with that weird accent when he's talking to Bruce Wayne and really like sizing him up. I just love like that typical mobster vibe.
And then that line that ends that exchange. You always fear what you don't understand. Boom.
Tom Wilkinson is basically the Bumman Irani of Hollywood. Isn't he?
Bumman Irani sucks. What are you talking about?
Bumman Irani is awesome. And Tom Wilkinson is the same way. Just consistently reliable. He can do any role that requires a middle-aged, slightly portly man to play. He can just kill it. And he did in this movie. So I concede Tom Wilkinson, but Cillian Murphy and Liam Neeson, who was wasted. Cillian Murphy was miscast. By the way, you know, Cillian Murphy tried out for Batman. And there's screen tests of him where he's Bruce Wayne, including wearing the cowl. And Nolan said he shot the screen tests on film, including with full makeup, full costume, just to make it feel as realistic. It is so weird and so funny. Like, that's the only time I respect Christian Bale's casting, when you see Cillian Murphy play Batman.
I agree with you about Scarecrow. I don't agree with you when you say that Scarecrow is supposed to be the villain in the movie. They've not tried to show that at all. The only villain in this movie is Ra's al Ghul, and for the most part of the movie, that's Ken Watanabe.
Is it Watanabe? Is it Watanabe? I don't even know.
Watanabe?
Is it what? I think it's Ken Watanabe. I don't know. All I know is that it's actually Bald Ken Watanabe.
Yeah, so Bald Ken. We'll call him Bald Ken. So
by the way, his English is better in this movie than it was multiple years later in the movie Inception. Inception.
Yeah, so Ra's al Ghul is supposed to be the main villain of the movie. And Scarecrow is not. And Scarecrow is kind of shown as a fuddu in the movie. And I respect that. They've not tried to hype him up as this serious villain in the movie. Do you remember the exit scene? His exit scene in the movie? Katie Holmes tasers his face.
Yeah.
And then he just goes away and then he's never seen. It's perfectly shown. They've shown him as a fuddu.
He comes back in Dark Knight Rises.
And Dark Knight as well. But he's, again, shown as a fuddu in both those movies as well. So they haven't tried to portray Scarecrow as the main villain here. The main villain is always Ra's al Ghul.
But the third act relies on Scarecrow's serum, toxin, whatever the hell that
has been, which has been distributed because of the League of Shadows.
Okay,
not because
I'm not
of
saying
Scarecrow.
What the League of Shadows is doing at the bank. Apparently, they were responsible for the fall of Rome.
I am the League of Shadows.
Nope, you're jumping ahead. Bane was
I
not
just
in
love
this
doing
movie.
That. I love doing that.
So apparently Ra's al Ghul has been responsible for the fall of Gotham also during the Depression, which they tried through a new weapon, economics. So it's one of those Spider-Man things where every villain is linked to the hero somehow. You know, like, oh, his father died basically because this guy was really poor and desperate. And the reason this guy was poor and desperate was because of the League of Shadows. It's almost like Guardians of the Galaxy 2, where eventually he just says, oh, by the way, and I killed your mom. Something that you think happened by chance happened because of the main villain and the main protagonist
except,
having some connection.
Except in Guardians 2, he directly killed his mom. And in this, it's things happening, things turning, the city going into depression, people not having jobs, people becoming desperate. You think, like, it's not even worth talking about here, but do you think the guy who shot them knew that it was Bruce and Martha Wayne?
No, they didn't. I'm not saying that that's the case. It is weaker if you just forcefully... making it so, with this economics being the connection between the League of Shadows and his parents' death. Anyway, coming back to Scarecrow, the whole third act is people getting scared based on Scarecrow's serum. Two things I've realized Nolan cannot do, and I respect the man. One, action. action in this movie sucks. The scenes where Batman looks all iconic and the cinematography is great and he's, you know, his cape is making him into a bat against like the night sky, great. But anytime he's fighting, it's so lame. And then I really thought about it. Nolan never figured out action. His action scenes in this movie are horrendous. You can never see what Batman's actually fighting like. It's like quick cuts. It's basically like Paul Greengrass in the Jason Bourne movies. If he didn't do the shaky cam and if Jason Bourne wasn't actually kicking ass. Just quick cuts, quick cuts, quick cuts, quick cuts. It's like Taken when they make Liam Neeson do action scenes because he can't move. He can't do those. Nolan can't do those, which really sucks. It really kills the action in the movie. Second, horror. The scarecrow stuff was supposed to be scary, right? Like when people are looking at scarecrow, they get scared. What is it that they keep showing? Usually it's just like a demon with like red eyes or something like that. Once in a while, it's the scarecrow mask with maggots coming out. How lame was that? And they start moving the camera. That was so, so weak. I would expect a lot better from Nolan.
To your point about Nolan and action specifically, so just a side note on Nolan, he doesn't use second units, which is staple in Hollywood movies with directors. They use a second unit which takes care of all the action sequences, so they don't have to direct them.
Yeah, and he should use second units.
No, he shouldn't use
He should use experts.
No, I'll tell you what's different with Nolan's action, which I don't agree with your point about the action sucks. I quite like it. He uses single cameras for action sequences, and he only uses multi-cameras for stunts. And those single camera action units actually look really, they're part of his cinematic reality and how to make it more real. So if you would be using multi-cuts or a second unit, it would look like an action movie. It'd look like a Michael Bay movie. And that's not what he's going for. And I'm really glad that he isn't.
Make it look like a Jason Bourne movie. Make it look like any movie where the superhero's power is action, right? Batman is an action hero. He barely outsmarts his enemies. He tends to actually outkick his enemies. So the action needs to be good.
I quite liked it, actually. And to the point of horror and generally talking about the third act where all of this plays out mostly, I have a concession to make. I'm not the biggest fan of the setting they created in the Narrows or the set design, essentially, that was used. Like, very foggy, very dimly lit, everything was muted. It was primarily to... You remember that one sequence where everyone's has inhaled the poisonous gas or whatever it is?
It was like the ending of a Scooby-Doo episode, the setting, the production design.
It was pretty weak. It's probably the weakest sort of sequence that I've seen Nolan do, but I understand why he did it.
Boom. Boom. Hey, the weakest sequence. That's a huge concession.
No, it's not. It's Nolan. His weakest sequence is by miles better than any stronger sequence that other directors do. But to my point, I understand why he made that setting, like that foggy sort of environment there. It was primarily for the settings to look a little supernatural so that, you know, you'd see how people are scared and like just imagining their worst fears and stuff. And the second reason for it to happen was to show that sequence where Batman's gliding over the Narrows and all the inmates are looking up and then he's just this like bat with weird eyes, glowing eyes and stuff. I think
he's an idea. He's a legend. He's a symbol.
My God. It works perfectly with that theme. He's trying to scare people with not being Bruce Wayne, but with being this thing which people can't relate to, people don't understand, and people fear at a very fundamental level.
Wasn't the whole point of him dressing up as a bat is that people fear him? So when they look at him as a bat, they shouldn't even see him as a demon. They should just see him as the bat. If they just shown that, that'd be cool. That'd be at least playing with the horror aspect of
like
what people see.
Or like a big bat?
Yeah, I mean, that's why he did it. Also, this whole thing of him dressing up as a bat to strike fear in his enemies' hearts. What was it? So that my enemies dread what I fear or something.
I'll use fear against the enemies who...
So that his enemies share his dread. It's time my enemies share my dread of my fear of bats. What logic is that? He's afraid of bats. Bats inherently are not that scary. Most people are not afraid of bats. So by that logic, I should just dress up as what I'm afraid. I'll be clown man. It's time my enemies shared the dread of my fear of clowns.
That doesn't have the same sinister ring, but you're more than welcome to try.
But my point is, it's meant to be something very deep and very like, oh my God, this is like something that Ra's al Ghul has finally helped him unlock. It's actually pretty stupid. You can be like needle man if you're afraid of needles.
No response to that one. I'm so sorry. I'm trying, but there's no response to that one.
Yeah, you keep your responses to yourself. I'll just throw this out there. The DC animated universe did it better. Each and every one of them. The worst DC animated movie is better than this shit.
Which is?
It's Batman Year One. Aha, didn't expect me to name one, did you?
I did not, actually. I didn't know. I'm pretty sure you haven't seen it.
I watched, actually, all of them maybe like a couple of years ago, and they're really, really good.
They are really good, 100%.
This movie is not 100%.
This movie is so good. The biggest thing I'm disappointed about is why, or whatever the contractual obligations are and the timing of things have been or whatever, but Christopher Nolan's Batman will not be part of the DC universe, which is today Ben Affleck trying to do whatever he's doing. I'm so upset about
that. Thank God.
Thank God.
It doesn't fit. If nothing else, it doesn't fit, right?
It'll revolve around this then. That's what would have happened, because they see this as the main property and they'll revolve the entire universe around it. And no doubt that universe would have been excellent.
The genre has moved on, my friend. Like, this was crazy disruptive at the time and it really no longer is. If you want to watch the current version of this cinematic realism genre, whatever you're talking about, it's actually on Netflix. Like Marvel's Daredevil, that's probably the closest it comes to totally realistic. The guy is just basically a ninja as well.
I see what you're saying about Marvel's Daredevil, but it's a different medium. It's a show. This is a movie. They're supposed to be different. And to encapsulate and to achieve everything that people try to achieve by creating a show or a series, and this dude doing it in one movie, it blows my mind away. Every movie that he does is a defining movie of its time. Every movie, Insomnia onwards, is a defining movie. And it just...
This was practice to make the defining movie.
I completely disagree. There are so many elements of this movie which were unheard of, or which directors didn't even know or realize that they could extract from their actors or from their script. For instance, the CGI, all right? Nolan only used about 600 CGI shots in this movie, whereas a big...
That's a lot of CGI shots relative to the Batman movies of the past. Just because CGI was happening in the world at the time doesn't mean that by not using it, he really changed the genre. Batman and Robin lived in this fake universe on purpose, right? But the previous Tim Burton Batman movies, even that stupid Val Kilmer one, I think it was called Batman Forever.
They didn't have CGI at that time. You need to understand that too as well, right? CGI is a technology that came up in front of us late 90s, early 2000s. For him to use 600 CGI shots in a Batman movie, whereas a normal action movie uses at least 1500 or 2000 CGI shots, just goes to show that what he's attempting to do is so much more pure. So in his own words, let me just put it in his own words. He says the CGI can be used for two things. One is to show a seamless transition or a seamless sequence of something that happens in reality, which is what he prefers. And the second use case of CGI is to just show the audience how much money has been spent on CGI, which is your typical Marvel movie. And you don't even realize that he's used CGI in this movie because he's such a great filmmaker. And action directors, normal directors would take cue from him. They would learn from him and try to implement that in their movies, albeit failing most of the time, I presume.
Where's the joy, dude? Where's the joy? I want to see Batman with Robin. I want to see them fight Poison Ivy, a punny Arnold Schwarzenegger. This movie's just joyless. And at best, if you consider it a work of art, then it is at best the first half of a really good two-part movie where you have to include The Dark Knight because Rises sucks. So this is basically like, maybe it's like the part one of Gangs of Wazipur. It's like the Terminator 1 of the franchise.
Brilliant.
It was just practice. Yeah, Terminator 1 sucks
compared to
2.
My argument here isn't that this movie is better than The Dark Knight. My argument here is that this movie deserves to be on the top 250, and there's no way around that.
Hey, you want to see Batman fight Bane eventually? First, you got to figure out how he bought his gear. First, you got to figure out which Chinese company and which Singaporean company he constructed his cowl from.
I love that.
First, this is the funniest part. You have to watch him very Spider-Man and very Daredevil in Netflix style. Watch him put on like a haggard costume, like a very preliminary...
For a five-second scene.
Like a very preliminary version of his costume. And then put on a monkey cap. And then go and like meet Commissioner Gordon. And by the way, his escape strategy, you know how he keeps disappearing when somebody turns around? Turns out he just runs really fast. And in the beginning, he wasn't good at it. So Gary Oldman actually catches him. His escape strategy at the time, since he didn't have a cape, was to just jump off the building. Jump off the building from the fifth floor and just land on like the second floor of some other building and just bruise your chest.
Yeah.
What do you mean, this is meant to be your cinematic realism. It's so dumb.
Of course it's realism. He doesn't have a cape. He hasn't met Mr. Fox by then. He doesn't know what he has at his disposal. So he's doing what he can do with the best with
what
he has.
He's jumping off five-story buildings.
What do you expect him to do?
Not be an idiot?
It's fine, man.
When Spider-Man does it, he has powers. When he does it, he's just like jacked.
That actually drives home the point of realism in this movie. I have no problems with that. I love that they showed that sequence. And it's a five-second sequence. He doesn't have his cowl. He doesn't have Mr. Fox's Kevlar vested bulletproof.
It's so stereotypical. I mean, Spider-Man had already done this, man. Come on. Like, before they had the proper suit, Spider-Man does it in, like, a typical red-blue costume.
With his webs.
Yeah, he has powers. That's the difference.
Yeah. This guy has no powers.
This guy's a nut. He's basically American Psycho, no pun intended.
He's very smart. He's also had training from Ra's al Ghul and the League of Shadows by then. So he has that.
He's also really good at like machine shopping, yep, everything. Yep. He just has whatever.
Yep.
Whatever kid, human man. Intellect power you
smart
need.
Smart kid.
Smart kid.
Smart kid.
Smart kid who basically...
Smart, conflicted kid.
Oh my God. You're such a fanboy.
I am, and so are you. Just admit it.
Of Batman, of Nolan, but not this movie. Both of them can falter. Not
so
Batman's fault.
You love Batman, and then you love Nolan, but when the two come together...
Yeah. What about Dark Knight Rises? Aren't you on board with that? Don't you feel the same way?
It's the weakest Nolan movie, I agree. But it's not a bad movie overall.
By the way, I just want to throw this out there. I attended that conversation with Nolan thing live in Bombay when that happened. And some guy was over-enthusiastic. And when it came to his turn to ask a question, he was like, oh my God, I went to film school and I went for screenwriting. And the thesis that I wrote in my senior year was about how Batman has these dual identities. And in fact, Batman is his real identity. And Bruce Wayne is actually his fake persona.
That's plagiarism. That's plagiarism. Katie Holmes said that in the movie.
Exactly. When the movie ended, I was like, oh, wait, this guy had no original thought at all. And by the way, Nolan actually corrected him. First, he said, Nolan, in his typical British fashion, I'm going to keep it short because this is actually not relevant to the discussion we're having today.
Right.
But actually, when we wrote the movie, we thought about it as three personalities: public Bruce Wayne, private Bruce Wayne, which only Alfred gets to see, and Batman.
Oh.
Fascinating.
Makes a lot of sense, yeah.
Where did David Goyer go wrong? First, he wrote this movie where at least he had this level of thought, which I will concede is at least interesting relative to comic book persona. And then he eventually wrote shit like Suicide Squad. I mean, what was he doing?
I don't know what went on behind the curtains at Suicide Squad, but it had to be a shit show complete. That's super fascinating, man. I didn't realize that. It actually makes so much sense when you put it into context.
I can't believe Christian Bale gained 100 pounds of muscle to play this, by the way.
Yeah. Yeah, he did. Did you remember him from the movies before this?
He was in that Machinist movie or something, right? Where he was skinny as a dog.
Stick thin, dude. And then... the army rescue one, I don't even realize that.
Yeah.
Come on, man. Just knowing that there are three specific characters here just adds to the complexity of things, doesn't it?
Well, here's the complex part of that. When he's alone on the rooftop, he's been sprayed like a skunk by the scarecrow, which apparently is enough to take down the almighty Batman. He's on the rooftop. He's like dying and seeing scary bat visions and stuff. And he doesn't abandon his Batman persona. He's like, Alfred! Alfred! Alfred!
Wait, so you mean the voice?
Yeah, the voice.
The voice is not... He's not... I'm assuming that has something to do with the suit. I don't think he's recreating that voice, is he?
Nope. You're thinking of the Ben Affleck Batman, where they actually make it clear he has a voice modifier in his suit. I think he's just putting on the voice. Like, he literally, before he gets ready to be Batman, he paints his eyes. Now he paints his eyes black, puts on the cowl, and then just, like, does some gararas. I'm Batman. Alfred.
You know, to that point, there's this one scene where he ends up telling Rachel who he is when they're on the rooftop in the Narrows.
Yeah.
His voice is less growly then, if you notice.
Because he wants her to know how sweet, yeah.
Oh, okay. I still think it's a suit thing, though.
No, I don't think so. I think he's putting it on. And in fact, this was the weird part in The Dark Knight Rises when Catwoman does the disappearing act on him, which he usually does on people when they turn around, he's gone. Which, by the way, they continue for three movies. And then he talks to himself saying, like, so that's what that feels like.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, why does he talk to himself in that voice? Why does he talk to himself at all? That's basically a good example of the forced comedy in this movie. Like the pre-Marvel era comic book humor. It's so bad in this movie.
There's no humor in this movie.
Okay, agreed. But there's attempted humor. And that's why the resultant lack of humor is just sad. And by the way, Nolan and humor, turns out they don't go together that well either. So now we have Nolan's not good at action, shown by this movie.
Oh,
horror, okay. Shown by this movie.
Okay.
And humor. I mean, what is the humor in this movie? The biggest typical like button to a scene, like comedic button that Marvel is so good at this point, was one where he just beats the shit out of all of Falcone's men in that warehouse shipping dock area. And then turns out the homeless man he once gave a coat to just happens to be standing there, still homeless, by the way. Let's not comment on the plight of this poor man. He's just standing there. He's watched Batman beat these people up and he's just like eating like an ear of corn or something. And so that provides the opportune moment for Batman to turn around and say, nice coat.
But that's not humor. I don't think that's humor at all.
That is the humor of this movie. That's meant to be a comedic button to a scene.
I don't think so. It's just meant to be a button. it's a point of observation. It just ties everything where he leaves and then he comes back and how all of that comes together. And this individual, this homeless man, acts as that reference point of what he was when he left and what he's become when he's come back.
So you're saying intentionally the homeless man being the same as the actual point of showing him, but the joke is incidental. I think it's the other way. There's a lot of examples of injected humor. There's one where that cop just looks at the Tumblr, which, by the way, I think is a stupid name for the Batmobile. Call it the bloody Batmobile. Lean into the shit. But anyway, he looks at the Batmobile and then he goes, I gotta get me one of those. Like, these are lame, lame things. The comic book genre moved beyond this when it came to this realism. But of course, like, the Marvel movies capitalized on it. So you have to decide, what are you trying to do?
I think Marvel movies, firstly, to compare them with this series of the Dark Knight trilogy is, makes no sense. Because Marvel movies have full-on jokes. They have comedic scenes, right? They have interactions that revolve around humor. And in this situation, these are just one-off lines. And there might be maybe three or four in this movie. So to count them as injected humor, or Nolan attempting humor for some particular reason is... It's not. It's just there. It's a general remark. I see that car. I'm going to say I need me one of those too. So it's not necessarily humor. It's just point of noticing something. Just, I don't get it.
It felt on par with that line in Batman versus Superman when she was like, is she with you? No, I thought she was with you. It's like that kind of force injected comedy. The only real unintentional humor for me was how Batman runs away from Gotham, right? Like when he's a teenager in his early 20s. How? He literally runs away.
He runs towards the ship.
Breaks into a run.
He's running to a ship. He's at the docking yard. He sees a ship. The ship just blows the horn, which means it's about to pull away anytime soon. So he just runs towards it.
Yeah, but such a funny visual. It's literally like Bruce Wayne literally running away from his city.
I mean,
when you run away from a city, you don't actually run.
I think it's so real because... If this was an action movie or a cinematic, they try to show the scene in a cinematic way, they'd show him running properly or slow motion or something. Just so real. He sees a ship. He's had enough. He's just had that experience with Falcone and the homeless guy. And he's like, okay, I'm going to get on the ship and just F off.
He may as well have had a stick with a piece of cloth tied to it with all his belongings. And then he's going out like a cartoon and then just running away. It was so dumb. I mean, it wasn't dumb. I actually laughed when I saw that.
No, he may as well not, because he has no belongings. He's leaving everything behind. Point in case when he gives that coat to the homeless guy.
Point in case. Interesting. Is this the subversion that Nolan has taught you?
No, you know what I mean. Your point is kind of baseless and makes no sense in this feud, because he's leaving everything he has behind and he has a lot of belongings, right? And he's giving the last good thing he has, which is his coat, to a homeless guy, and he's running away, quite literally. So I actually thought that scene was pretty powerful.
That scene plus Alfred were the two funniest scenes to me in the movie. That and perhaps just spotting King Joffrey just being reduced to a wimpy child.
King Joffrey is not being reduced. That wimpy child came before King Joffrey was a thing.
It just goes to show, it's just a microcosm of all the wasted talent. You had the talent of King
firstly,
Joffrey.
Firstly, King Joffrey is a talent. I don't think he's a good actor.
Yeah, but he's a great King Joffrey.
No.
What?
He's not.
Jack Gleason or whatever his name is?
I don't know what his name is. I didn't even bother finding out. I don't think he's a good actor. I don't think he did justice to King Joffrey.
Well, in that case, Batman Begins cast failed. A shitty child actor.
Okay.
You can't win him.
Good
buddy.
Point, dude. Good point.
Once you see King Joffrey being utilized in this way, you can't win.
Okay, can we move on? I feel like these points are just, you're just ranting for no reason.
While we're on casting decisions, how have we not spoken about
Gary Oldman?
Ex-Mrs. Tom Cruise.
Oh, Katie Holmes. I forgot she was ex-Mrs. Tom Cruise.
How could you? Dawson's Creek and then Tom Cruise. Those are her two identities.
And then Oprah's jumping on the couch about her.
That's true. But I'll tell you what's not her identity. Rachel from Batman Begins.
I'm comparing her to Maggie Gyllenhaal, who played Rachel in the next two movies.
Let's talk about that. What further evidence can you need of an actor not doing her job than her being replaced in the next movie?
It wasn't because she didn't do her job. It was because of a contractual dispute.
What contractual dispute?
What do you mean, what contractual? There was a contractual dispute. She didn't agree to new terms for the two movies, so she didn't move forward and they just recast her because obviously Nolan doesn't care about that.
She basically roadied herself out of this franchise.
I don't know what she did, but it wasn't because she did a bad job as Rachel.
It clearly was. Why else would she not come back for like a 10-minute role in the next movie?
I'm not sure why she didn't come back, and I'm not sure what her role was going to be if she was going to continue with The Dark Knight and The Dark Knight Rises. but it wasn't clearly because Nolan or the team thought that she did a bad job.
Okay, forget the fact that she was replaced.
I actually quite liked her in this movie. I prefer her over Maggie Gyllenhaal.
Maggie Gyllenhaal wasn't that great, but I think the character wasn't that great in the next movie. There wasn't much to do except for be the...
crybaby.
Damsel in distress. And
quite literally.
And then not so distressed anymore after a while. But Katie Holmes, she looked like she was reciting lines of a book the whole time. She was just like staring intently at Christian Bale and then reciting a line. I thought she really sucked. How does she feel about the fact that she last met Bruce Wayne outside the courthouse where he was about to kill his parents' murderer? Then he reveals to her that he was about to do that by showing her the gun. He slaps him in the face, in the car. Doesn't she have any guilt about that? I'd be freaking out. I'd be like, oh, he used to be my best friend. Then I slapped him in the face. And then he's probably dead now. Oh my God.
Hmm. I mean, maybe she did. She had 7 years to get over it.
Wow. Wow. You make it sound so easy.
Dude, the guy was presumed dead. So she must have had some closure over these 7 years, right? She must have thought that he's dead. He's gone. He's dead. He's missing. Whatever it is.
Yeah, but these are exactly the kind of character things that I would expect an auteur like Nolan to explore. And it's so sad.
You said that mockingly.
I did.
I don't take too well to that.
Okay. What you going to do?
Meet me outside.
Are you going to gain 100 pounds of muscle like
No,
Christian
I don't
Bale?
Need 100 pounds of muscle. I'll just meet me outside after the shoot.
Wow. This is so Batman-y of you.
I don't like the tone you're taking with her. Batman-y and auteur.
You know what? The lack of joy in this movie has turned you into a joyless monster. If you'd watched Batman and Robin, Joel Schumacher's Batman and Robin right now, if you'd seen Batman skate around Gotham City instead of whatever he was doing. By the way, Batman in this Batman Begins has that little bat clicker where he just calls like
bats,
thousands and thousands of bats.
It's a frequency thing. You won't get it.
Oh yeah, I wouldn't get it. You know who might like to get it? The military. That's a great military device. Like imagine being anywhere and just calling thousands of bats. He should sell that. Do some good in the universe.
No, it'll be used as a terrorist weapon then. He knows. He already knows.
He's using it as a terrorist weapon.
No,
he's
an urban
terrorist.
The thing about bats, you need to understand that...
Wait, just stop. Don't even finish whatever stupid biology
The army
lesson.
Will never go for it, was my point. Because they're all scared of bats.
Oh my God.
Elemental.
Stop it.
Just so that I have you on record, you're saying Batman and Robin, that's the one with George Clooney, correct me if I'm wrong. The one with George Clooney and Chris O'Donnell, I want to say.
That's right.
So that movie...
And Uma Thurman and Arnold Schwarzenegger and an unnamed Bane.
Yeah. So that movie is at least as good, if not a better watch than Batman Begins, yes or no?
It has joy.
Yes or no?
You can't trap me into yes or no questions. Okay. Did you beat your wife last night? Yes or no?
No.
So then you beat her last night?
No.
Oh, so you beat her other nights, huh? Interesting.
No, I'm not married.
Point is, Batman and Robin had joy. I know it wasn't the best movie, but it had joy. Say it after me, joy. Also, Gotham City was fun. It was neon and it was like interesting things were happening. There were statues. It was like of the future. What is wrong with Gotham City here? The whole vibe of Gotham City is nothing. It's bleak. And then it's like the show don't tell version that there's a lot of crime. It's okay. There's cities like that, right? People complain. Even in the US, they complain about Chicago having a lot of crime. What does the League of Shadows want to destroy it for? What's so wrong with it? It's not Rome. It's just a city that has some crime. Big deal.
I know for a fact that Rises and The Dark Knight used a lot of Chicago for showing Gotham City, but the idea is to show it as a very New York, sort of the leading city of the world, right? Or at least of the USA. So to that capacity, it's touted to be bigger than Rome or any other city in the world. So yeah, I mean, it's fictional, right? At the end of the day, so they can only show.
Oh yeah, it's fictional. Yeah, it doesn't mean anything. So it can be anything. That's what's happening here. At one point, it's like the Rome. And at the other point, it's like the Chicago. At the other point, it needs to be destroyed. So dumb, dude. So dumb.
That point makes no sense because it's not like Rome or it's not like Chicago. It's a unique city in itself. And from all the visuals and all the talk that they have, like the economic center of the country and stuff like that, it started to be the New York of the Batman universe, right? So... To have something that catastrophic happen to New York City is going to be devastating for the world economy or the world in general. So that's what they're trying to show.
Boring. Yeah, Gotham City is like so bleak and boring. I mean, why does the League of Shadows even bother? It's just another lame city.
It's shown to be...
You're off, Mike.
It's shown to be the equivalent or superior of what a New York is today to today's world and economy, right? So I don't understand your point. Again, it's shown as a very important city, not just in the US, but in the world as well. So to have something catastrophic happen to that city will have ripple effects throughout the world.
So it's like a New York City, but it has a Narrows and it has an Arkham Asylum, which, by the way, what a waste of showing Arkham Asylum. They shoved that in there because, of course, they're rebooting it. They want to show it. And it's run by Cillian Murphy, which is like really stupid.
Oh, the psychiatric wing of Arkham.
Oh, I'm sorry. What is the other wing?
The normal prisoner cell thingamajig.
Oh, I thought they maybe have a dentist
They
wing.
Haven't shown it. Why are you obsessing about that?
That whole sequence I found really lame. But the funniest part of that sequence was after Rachel gets skunk sprayed by the scarecrow. And
you
then
said skunk like my elder mamaji does skunk.
Okay, after Rachel gets sprayed in the face. Wait, that doesn't sound right either. But basically, after Rachel is getting scarecrowed, she gets rescued by Batman in the tumbler. Then you remember what he does? He drives along the rooftops of Gotham, which is supposed to be a great action scene, but I can always tell that it's like a little miniature toy car being taken over the rooftops. But anyway, this woman is losing her mind, right? She got an extra dose. She's like 15 minutes away from total mental just breakdown, never to return. What does this man do? Our hero, Bruce Wayne, Batman. He takes her flying around rooftops in a car. Imagine the level of freak out. Have you ever been on a paranoia substance and been in a car? And now imagine being in that car on rooftops.
I have.
Oh, really? You have?
Yeah, it was interesting. I can relate to Katie Holmes now.
Shut the hell up. You know I'm right. This movie just there was so much potential. And maybe it was realized in a future movie. The sequel. Maybe. Maybe the next one actually did it way better.
Okay.
But this one didn't make the cut. I'm sorry.
I feel like your judgment is super warped here because you're, on one hand, you're holding it to the high caliber that you hold or to the high standard that you hold a Nolan movie to. And then on the other hand, you have this enormous task of arguing against it.
So, I don't. Easy. Easy peasy.
Easy peasy.
As easy as taking a flying car over a rooftop.
Yeah. I don't see problem with any of the points you've raised. I think a lot of them actually end up adding to the movie than taking away from it. And I've already said that this might be one of the weaker Nolan movies, but that in itself is such a huge statement because every movie he does again is huge and it's a game changer. So this movie as itself, when we compare it to the rest of the IMDb top 250, is a league apart from most of the other ones.
A league of shadows apart?
A League of Shadows.
Again, you can't do the Bane voice.
I am the League of Shadows.
Can we just get back one last point to the League of Shadows? So, Ra's al Ghul's big thing is that Bruce Wayne burnt his house down and left him for dead, right?
Favor. That was a favor by Ra's al Ghul.
Okay.
I mean, first, Bruce Wayne did that to him, so he just repaid the favor.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
He did not leave him for dead. Ra's al Ghul left Bruce Wayne for dead. Bruce Wayne stopped Ra's al Ghul from forming or falling off a cliff.
Villain hai. Thoda masala dalega na.
Then put him in like a monastery and told him to be taken care of. And then the guy was like, I'll tell Ra's al Ghul what you did.
But he didn't know that he was Ra's al Ghul then.
So?
In Bruce Wayne's head, he'd already killed Ra's al Ghul and he was saving a friend by the name of Mark Dembubu.
So Liam Neeson, Ra's al Ghul, is basically taking revenge for killing his Ken Watanabe, like fake Ra's al Ghul imposter. Makes sense. It makes sense.
No. What?
Why did Ra's al Ghul leave him for dead? He didn't do any such thing. And while we're talking about that, you know Batman's no killing rule? Totally gone in this movie. People complain when BVS had them killing. But in this movie, he kills straight up. He's also just making cop cars bounce around.
Yeah, I thought about that.
Did you now?
Yeah.
Did
so, you? Obviously, he kills off Ra's al Ghul. That becomes that one exception to the rule for this Batman's life.
He actually says, I'm not going to kill you, but I'm not going to save you. That's killing you, brother.
I agree. Yeah, that's more leaning towards killing than saving. So that I'm actually chalking off as a kill for Batman.
Okay, great. One kill for Batman. And what about the innocent cops?
The cops aren't dead, dude.
What do you mean the cops are?
The cars are pretty strong.
They're maimed. They're probably crippled.
No, man. Those cars have these like reinforced steel structure cages thingamajig within it. Like that's the whole point of a cop
not
car, man.
Not to mention psychologically just damaged for life.
They're just cop hai, practice mil rahi hai.
Crippled by a bat.
They're getting practice, dude.
And not the wooden
one. On the hard streets of Gotham. They need it, bro. Batman's doing them a favor.
They need it. The Joker's come.
Every cop car should be flipped thrice in their life for a cop to be hardened.
You're just handing me this feud. You're just handing it to me.
I'm entertaining you right now because none of your points make sense. So I was like, let's just go into that direction, that realm of things where we're just talking rather than feuding about the movie. And I'll happily indulge you, man. Let's do it.
Gee, thanks. Thanks for granting me this victory. I appreciate it.
You know, one thing we haven't talked about at all during this feud is this is a first collaboration between Chris Nolan and the legendary Hans Zimmer.
Ooh. Shows. It shows that it's the first.
I mean, there are some teething problems, man, but Hans Zimmer, dude, he'll knock it out of the park if I give him a brief, and I don't know shit about musical score.
Turns out what I need to do to win any feud with you is to just feud long enough, and eventually you'll just start handing me gifts.
How is this a gift?
You just said teething problems. Yeah, it's not that great.
It's the same logic, all right? This might be one of the weak Nolan movies. This might be one of the weak Hans Zimmer scores, but if you take them as individual scores or movies, they're so much better than everything out there. So I don't see a problem with that. It's not the best Zimmer score, but it's still so damn good.
There was nothing extraordinary about the score, dude. Like, there was one Batman theme that was memorable, but I actually can't even remember it enough to hum it, maybe right now. But Hans Zimmer and Nolan started taking it to the next level with movies like Interstellar, where it was just, you know, a lot of focus on the audio. Dunkirk, where they used that beat where it constantly built tension. This was another movie score. Any of the Marvel people might have done it.
Really?
Yeah.
Seriously, really? I mean, I think we've done enough of a BVS or Marvel comparisons with this movie. They don't hold up. You're literally, for the audience, you're granting me the feud every time you mention or compare these movies to BVS or Marvel. For your own sake, I would suggest that you stop.
Hans Zimmer did it better in Man of Steel. Yes or no?
No.
What?
No.
At least it was memorable. Ta-dung, ta-dung,
no,
ta-dung.
I despise that movie and everything about that movie.
That's a theme. That's a theme. That's like a new Superman theme for our generation. Sad as the movie might be, but at least it's catchy. It's memorable. That's weak, dude. Hans Zimmer had done Pirates before this. Hans Zimmer did Man of Steel and many things after this. This movie, meh, well, whatever. First collaboration. It's okay. Good. It led to something good in the future.
I think you're trying to put too much weightage into the whole first collaboration point. It's just a point of note that this is their first collaboration and a long-lasting relationship. But that doesn't mean...
Hum the theme for me right now.
No, and the theme that you just hummed for Man of Steel right now sounded like an effing nursery rhyme to me. So
it's a theme, bro.
I didn't like it.
The Superman theme from a long time ago, the 70s original movies, they were memorable for a reason. This is just not memorable. You can't hum it.
I think... I don't put as much weightage in terms of how memorable a theme is, but I put more weightage in terms of how the music is making me feel when I'm watching the movie, which is what it's there for. And I certainly felt a lot of scenes in this movie were enhanced by the score that was put on top of that scene. So
ab enhanced to hoga hi na. That's the whole point of a score. It's Hans Zimmer. Kuch to enhance karega hi.
Bahut enhance kara. That's my point. I'm not saying this is the best. That, again, same point. It's not the best Hans Zimmer score, but that doesn't mean it's a bad score. It's a great score.
Okay. Obviously, I disagree. I think it's time we ended this. I think just like the movie, this feud has gone on a tad too long. So why don't we end it? Let me offer my short summary.
Jaldi kar.
Okay. Ready? I think this movie should have been called, open quote, My Obsession with Cillian Murphy and Michael Caine Begins. End quote.
And Hans Zimmer?
And Hans Zimmer. Obsessed ho gaya yaar banda. Har picture mein.
Yeah.
Inception mein toh sense bhi nahi banta tha Michael Caine ghusa diya. Dunkirk mein sense nahi banta tha Cillian Murphy ghusa diya. I'm surprised Michael Caine wasn't in Dunkirk actually. What a shock.
Actually, I'm glad that...
Which makes me think Dunkirk should have been called, quote, My Obsession with Michael Caine Finally Ends. And by the way, it happens to be during the Second World War. End of quote.
What? And if he happens to have Michael Caine in his next movie?
Then it would be The Michael Caine Rises.
Oh, that's funny, Vidur. See, that's why I like you.
Oh, are we back to being friends?
Yeah. I still want to see you outside, though.
So, guys, that was this week's episode of Film Feud. Thank you for listening.
Now, we feuded, and you guys decide who you think won this week's feud. You guys can find us on Facebook and Instagram at Film Feud Podcast or on Twitter at Film Feud Pod.
And don't forget to subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, CastBox, wherever you happen to listen to our show. If you're on iTunes, please leave us a rating or a review.
You can also find us on munchermedia.com. Till next week.
Bye-bye.